guys would throw it on the same side that they have the net, but the best leg riders in the country actually do it the opposite way. Right? It's about creating leverage for them, right, and putting a lot of weight on you. But right, my coach for many years, Mark Perry, right, one of the best leg riders to ever do it. And how he would do it. This is probably why I learned how to stop him.
You're facing that kind of field, you don't lose, you're learning
to get away, or you're tortured for however long he wants to keep going. I know most guys are going to throw a leg on this side, right? And so, what I don't want to do, if a guy is good with legs, is I can't afford to get returned in a bad way, right? I can't afford to get lifted and return back to the mat, because when I get lifted, my legs are in some trouble, right? So, guys good with legs, he's slipping on this side. Now, instead of exploding up and getting my stand up, what I'm gonna do is I'm just gonna push back and keep this elbow in, right? High school wrestlers aren't very patient. Not the other ones. Some of them are, they're not. But a guy that has to throw legs to right to turn and do things like that, I've never met someone, best leg riders, I've never met anybody that won't throw anyways, right? They're gonna do it. Right? You can bank on that. If they're gonna throw their leg in, it's just a matter of when. I know that's kind of a heavy generalization for leg riders, but leg riders, their main objective is to get that leg in and then start setting up their own positions. So they have to throw it. They're going to throw it. It's going to happen. It's about staying strong down there and waiting for that leg to come in. Right. So what I mean by staying strong is the starting position starts, boom. And I'm just staying here, right? I'm pushing back into him. And it's not gonna be that drastic, but I'm just waiting here, right? I don't want this. The second I get here, he's slipping that leg in. Right? So I'm controlling here, staying tight, and I'm waiting for him to throw that leg over. As he throws it in, I'm just catching it. He's gonna do it, right? Because most leg riders, good, they know most guys are gonna give up there. Right? They're gonna have a lapse in judgment and either raise their hand up and they're still gonna slip it in. Or what I've actually experienced is a lot of guys go like this and then they'll go and guys will panic. They're thinking, oh no, right? This guy's slipping a leg in. I better get his weight that way. Right? So they defeat themselves before knowing that they're actually in control. Right? You defeat yourself by slipping that arm out, which you should never do. I mean, if you think about scrambling, I mean, his legs over my arm, here, you would never tell your kid to turn down just yet here, right? Over his foot. Right? Unless he's like on his back. You wouldn't tell your kid to just give up in this position, right? And that's really important, is telling them to stay with it. Is like, instead of like keeping your elbow in like this, tight to your body, once he slips and he traps it, you have to create space here, right? By either pushing your arm out. What I like to do is I like to lower my levels and push over the side. Right, and now, I mean, everything, it's pretty easy to get a reversal or get an escape, anything, just elevate. But here what happens actually a lot. So you throw that leg in, right, I'm here. And if you guys have all had strong wrestlers, right, the probably the best thing you can do is just tell them, say they can't get their hips trapped because they're here, right? A lot of guys grab onto the leg and it's super annoying. Right, is you just take the foot up. Take the foot up there. Elevate the foot. He's in some trouble. Right? He tries to hang on. He's gonna be in some trouble. Right? Even there, all I gotta do is, see, I started already taking his weight. So he grabs onto his foot. getting his weight out there. And that's essentially 90% of the defense against leg riders, is being patient, knowing that he's going to throw that leg in, but having an answer for when he's there, right? Not letting him throw his legs in to throw on a bare leg, right? Keeping that hand down, not like this, like we're ready to catch something. We're ready to catch his leg, or we're taking it over, or either creating space there. Anybody got any questions about that position before I go over?
So I got about 5 kids that could probably use that. Everybody else is going to let the legs completely in, not catch it. We promote hands fight hands, feet fight feet. Anything you can add to that philosophy? Once the leg is in, and they're putting pressure on you, and putting pressure on your hands,
yeah,
and extending
you.
Okay, great.
When you're getting ready,
the worst part is
cat on the floor, ready to go.
As far as getting away, is he figure fours my leg? And I'm like this. Extremely painful. Right? No matter, I don't care who you are, this position sucks. Everybody.
No, because it's going to arch the spine.
Like Coach said, feet fight feet and hands fight hands. But feet do fight feet, but you should also fight with your hands. Right? You should use the tools that you have. But doing it the right way. So he slips the leg, and I'm here. Right? My initial goal is to not let this foot get over my ankle. Right? So if he gets that foot over my ankle, this is much harder to get away from. Right? But if he's on the inside still, he's not in that good a position yet. He's got the advantage. Right? Everyone see what I'm doing here? I'm keeping my ankle up and not letting him step over my foot. Right? That would give him full control over the hip and leg. Right? So he slips it, and I'm like, I'm making sure that he's not getting over that foot. Okay? Right there. Right here. Before we take him to a hip, just some things that we can do to get away. Right here, what I do is, again, we gotta keep that weight back, guys. It's paramount. It's important. The second I start going here, is we start getting in trouble. Right, I want to keep my weight back. I want to find his foot with my foot. Right. The easiest way to get out of legs in a bad position is you push off the knee and you push off the ankle. Right. So I can either go here, take it, start taking it. And boom. Right? Throwing his weight a little bit off me and just stepping over. Just step over. Real easy. Right? We're pinching his ankle to the mat. And then we're stepping out. Right? Here. Boom. Not letting him over our ankle. Getting our weight back a little bit. Stepping. Throwing his weight just a little bit. And say he's clean to my body. Right? It's the same thing. Right, now he's under both sides, which is going to be hard to get away after I get out, but there's always answers. Is foot on foot, pinch it down to the mat, and just hip over. Right, and I think a lot of guys go, yeah, that sounds easy in practice, like you're not wrenching on your head. Right, but mat wrestling is a lot about being stubborn and being tough. And sometimes there's no way around it. That's the unfair reality of our sport, is you could have the best technique, the most flawless, whatever. But if you don't have that element of toughness there to stay strong when a guy's wrenching on your head and putting weight on your hips, is you're just not gonna get away. You're not meant to get away, right? So you have to stress that. When he's really in there, over my ankle, I hate this position, right? So we start here, we like, again, like, I force myself to be in these kind of positions in college so I can know what to do. What I want to do is, there's 2 things I can do, right? I have to set up my attack just like I would on my feet. Is I need to start pushing his knees in, right? There's a lot of weight.
Your session, man.
I could take off my body by just going.
I didn't pay attention to it.
I want to take him to a hip. Right, a lot of times guys just go like this. Much harder to do it than not going to my hip first.
Almost all his coaches, I guess, would be one.
Yeah, pretty much I'm in the same position, I'm just on my hip.
Every day, and
like
practicing, you know, arching back and surfing and stuff. And it paid off for him.
I need some
good question on whether you want to invest the time.
This in and shift his weight.
I do spend a lot of time on this.
And that is what
you should teach your kids how to defend.
Everyone see here?
I think they know how to leg ride. They get no match. It's
under
my arm.
I know. If you could stress,
it's very frustrating too.
To not let under your arm first.
That's why I feel like the pushback series that Richard, did you watch Richard's last show?
Yeah.
Because it gets rid of 90% of the issues.
Just like with wrestling on our butt, it's about getting
my biggest
one side
about is I've tried
under
to
control first,
like a power switch,
and then we can get away.
Like reaching back
right.
And high, so I'm just
going to push back
or stand up off
the
window. That makes sense. Because they kept doing
it. I really figured out for riding myself is if a guy is under both sides of my arm, pretty hard to get away. So when I'm on my hip, I need to first get a hand out.
So much shit.
Right? I like to get the outside hand and get this elbow tight. Right? Because now he can't do the rip back stuff. If he's under both, and he's got my wrist here, it's pretty easy for him to rip me back. Right? If I take it out, he goes to try to rip me back down. I'm staying in. Right? See how I'm keeping tight to myself? Second I get extended, I'm going over. Staying tight, elbow in, and I'm pinching his thigh.
You're probably just protecting yourself first.
Right? I'm dictating where the wrestling is taking place. What I want to do, next is just push his outside. So we're pinching his legs together. What we gotta do, I'm pinching his legs together. Right, he's holding on. Right, and this is probably the most frustrating part, is guys will do this. I'll try to go here, and then all of a sudden they're getting distracted and they're getting ripped right back. Right? You gotta be able to dictate. So I'm looking, and I don't really look anymore, but it's a useful tip at first. So I'm up. Right? He's gonna be ripping me up here. Right? So I want to hug the knee. This is what's really really important. Here. Thigh, I'm staying on his knee. And I'm pushing that foot out. Right? And then I'm getting back in. Tight. I need to take this foot and just rest it on the outside hip. Right? Guy grabs his, it's actually the hardest to get away from now in this position is when he grabs his own foot. Right? It's an annoying little stall tactic here. He's just holding on. What I like to do is I like to take the foot and take it up and in and out. Right? It hurts. It's not, there's nothing to it other than it's supposed to put him in pain. Right, because here, we're fighting. He's hanging out for dear life. Here, I'm not letting him get onto this other side. I can't afford to do that. When I isolate, I have to take his foot and take it, bar it with my elbow. Everyone see this? Kind of illegal to do if you're just doing it in a scramble, right? Basically taking the ankle, and going like that. A little bit of pressure.
Yeah.
Right. Going. Out with it. I'm creating like a curl bar effect here, so I can get it here. And for me, I mostly hold on to it, like because this is pretty bad position to be in for him, picking his foot up, and it's painful. Right, but I think probably a better price, guys, is once they get it here, is to go pull under, right, under, and keep that space with my elbow here. Right, and now we can start coming back. I don't like the going into him. I think we're having to like step over his hip. Never been very good at it. Here, he has no real control. Even if he kind of grabs his ankle or whatever, grabs his ankle, right? As long as I go up, I'm taking the weight back. Right, and that's pretty important when wrestling a leg rider is he wants to feel comfortable. And I have to threaten him. I gotta take the foot up back. Right? We get our elbows and stuff like that. And a lot of anytime you can get that foot here on your elbow or the opposite side of your elbow, is you wanna get it up. You know, whether we're there or I have his leg here like this. We don't wanna fight like turn our shoulder into him. We wanna get it up. much, much more effective. You still score, and if you step over that hip, but it's so much more effective is when you get it up. Same thing when we're catching the legs. We want to get it up over our head. Very, very, very hard for him to defend. Here, and our guys were doing this yesterday, and I'm screaming from the corner. I'm like, you gotta do this, and I'm like, they don't know how to do this, right? They don't know the position, right? They've never felt it for themselves, never forced themselves in that position, even though I know that they should be. We'll change that. But here's probably the worst position, right? I just want to like butt down and stay strong. We need to relieve the pressure. Right? The only way I'm gonna relieve the pressure is by going foot to his foot or ankle or knee here, and I just gotta push myself out. You're gonna get away there.
Could
you do it right?
Could you turn around and do it?
Tough. You have to be tough and strong. But how you get out of this figure four leg drive is you just go hip down. And once you got hip down, gotta be strong for a second. Get your foot in.
Can you turn around?
Sorry about that. Don't worry, Corey. Gotta get hip down and help you get that foot back. All I'm going to do is push and fly. That's how you relieve the pressure. It's really nothing to that except making sure you can't do it if your hip's not down. You have to go from here to here and kick away. And then start working up and stuff like that. All right. Enough mat wrestling. Sorry. I scored from that position on anybody in the world. But it was never just an automatic thing for me. Right? I always had an underhook, but I never did it right until I got to college, right? Or I started wrestling at a world level. And what I think of right may not be the conventional underhook head on the same side. Right? I want actually my head to be on the opposite side, right? We always stress head position. Right, but with this underhook, it's a different kind of control type of that. It's a different feel. Most guys that wrestle me say, well, I've never felt an underhook like that. Well, the point is, it's not a normal underhook, right? It's almost like a pinch lock without locking my hands. Right? I want to pinch. My goal is to get his head here. Why? When his arm and his head are here, right? He's here like this. And all of a sudden, he's like this. Head goes with the arm like that. You need to straighten up, right? That's why we need to sag our weight back. Right, so a lot of my biggest goal when in an underhook is to get his knee straight. Right? But get him to go from here to like here. Right? And there's obviously answers to that underhooks. But I also develop attacks from proper defense from there. So really, guys, there's no trick to get to an underhook, right? I go from either an elbow tie, or a shot, or just a collar dig. Sometimes it's that easy. Even against world-level wrestlers, it's not easy, but it's with purpose. It's with focus. I know where I'm going when I put my hand, right? I'm a left-side underhook, right? Just a collar dig, because I'm taking his head to my shoulder, and right, what happens when I pull? Hands start coming up. That's what I want. I want that reach just a little bit. I'm slapping his shoulder. Okay. Where I'm putting my hand, very important to creating that like suction-like motion, or that suction-like feel, because I'm in the middle of the back. Fingertips are in the middle of the back. Palm is on the shoulder blade. Right? I have a grip here. Okay. What I want is here and here. What I'm going to do next is just throw his head to the near side, right? And most guys will just let you do that because they think, dude, I'm getting head position on him, right? I'm getting head position. I have a defense here, right? It's a defense. Head's in. Right? The next most important thing is I need to keep my elbow a little bit elevated, right? It's going to be hard for the guy winging down. But I have to keep my elbow up somewhat. If my elbows are in, very hard to score here. Just a little bit. And I need to control both sides. What happens a lot, guys, hands come up, right? I'll either go elbow, inside control, or wrist. I really don't like the wrist because it's still too loose, right? You can do a lot of things. But elbow, love it. Inside control, even better. I'm controlling both sides of the body. Okay. When I'm here, I'm strong and I'm tight. And what I'm gonna do is, I know when I'm ready to attack, when I turn my head in. So you see where his head's at? Where my head's at, to the side a little bit. But the second I go here, I'm pinching his arm and his head together. And what happens a lot of times is guys are gonna start trying to throw this arm over, right? What happens when they throw that arm over, they go straight knee. Right, this is what we're looking for. I'm pinching here, he goes to throw it over, right? And he's giving me knee pull, sweep single, throw by. Okay? And for the most part, guys, the attacks, honestly, they're very basic. Right? But I'm not giving him an option. He's giving this to me because I'm dictating the ties. Right? I think that's really important. It's not here. I get a good shot, but it's not like I'm shooting, John Sethlow singles where my timing is just perfect. Right? I'm in here and I'm controlling, I'm making him feel uncomfortable. The second he starts to throw that hand over, I'm just going to drop. Most guys are really confused by this because they go, okay, do you want to have a jump side and start throwing the hand over? Right, and I want to go here. You're high cross knee pull. If you're going to shoot a knee pull or a high cross from an underhook, it's very hard to get there on a good wrestler. Right, why? Because he goes underhook on me, same side head position, and he goes to the high cross here. Not necessarily everyone's going to do that, but we're going to highlight. Right? He goes to the outside, and I'm going to highlight. And you're going to miss a bunch of times. Right? And the position is too precious to give up with a miss. Right? So, that's why I want you. Because when I go to an outside step or a high cross, I'm getting to the leg. Cool. There's no high leg there. If he tries the high leg, I'm basically taking his chest over my back. Which stops that highlight comes from here. That down block highlight. You gotta get your head down, right? If you can't really get your head down, you can't really. If you do this, right? If my head's up and I'm going over, you can only throw your leg back so far, right? So we're here, controlling both sides. I'm turning my head in, and I'm just throwing this arm up, and I'm stepping in. High crotch. Basic high crotch here. My big thing here is getting that backhand deep. Right? He can still sprawl here, right, and defend me, things like that. But if I get off my trail, I gotta get off my trail leg, and I gotta get my backhand deep. I get my backhand deep, he goes to sprawl. It's not a sprawl there. Right? I have kind of a philosophy with finishes, is that if you can get up, that's the best way to finish. Right? If you can pick him up, even better. There's no defense when a guy is his feet are off the mat. There's no bump rolls or nothing like that. But if you can't get his feet off the mat, you gotta get one off the mat. Right? So I was in Budapest this summer, World Championships, and I was Kyle Dick's partner. And I spent a lot of time with the coaches. Bill Zadek, he's head coach of the Team USA, he brought up a statistic that really resonated with me. He said at the world level, 92.3% of takedowns were scored when a guy got a foot off the mat. Right, so he took weight off of both feet and just got even just one up. But if you can get one foot up, your chances of scoring go way up. Instead of, I'm doing this, and his feet are both on the mat, I still finish for sure. Right? But if I could that foot up, then he's in some trouble. Okay. That's just as basic high cross you can get. Backhand deep. Want to get that foot. Kind of, I think about getting it to the outside hip, right? Because I can double off. What I don't want to do is these. Right, the shorter amount of time I can spend on my knees, the better my finish is going to be. Right, real basic, but so important. Your trail leg has to come up in your vision. Everyone, you understand what that means? much easier. Next thing, just a knee pull, and I will go, I think this is just basic, but it's the same kind of thing. It's the same, same ideal. You get the foot up, you're probably going to score. So, here, instead of going to a high crotch, right, I'm either going to go knee pull or sweep single, whatever is doing me, really. They're really interchangeable, honestly. Knee pull, go here, sweep single. Alright, the only thing different is the step. But it's not really the shot, it's where I'm shooting to. That's very important. When I'm shooting, my goal, you don't always get this, but you gotta stress it, you're drilling, is you don't wanna create like a wide, like sweep, or like a wide knee pull, but you need to get your knee behind this. Or knee behind, I call it knee behind knee. Why? It's because when we shoot sweep singles and we don't get knee behind knee, this leg can go back. And right now we're here. It's a much harder fight. When I'm here, my foot's behind his foot, what happens? He goes to get that leg out, I can get it up. So I get my knee behind his foot, when you stress that point, it's much easier to finish. Right? Everyone, I think a lot of guys, when I was wrestling in college, they were like, he's really strong, like that's his thing, right? And then it really was, I was stronger than most of my opponents, but I made it a lot easier on myself by doing these things right. Right? It looks so much easier when you're in a good position to do it right, right? Realistically, I'm not that much stronger than most of my opponents. It's the attention to detail when I'm in a scoring position that makes it look like he's just lifting him up. It's really the attention to detail there. So, when I sweep, just a real easy thing that I like to do is, when you first learn this, is learning how to extend your arm and your foot together. Right? Shooting with a purpose. And you're almost never going to get really here. This is basically the position. But, it's probably going to be more here. Right? And what I want to do is either, I like to split my hands even though it's not necessarily the best for some guys. I need to split my hand, and my goal is to get this foot to my outside hip. Right? I want to get pulled. Knees behind knees. There's no real defense unless he rolls under, he goes a little under. This happens a lot, but my knees are behind his knees. It's pretty easy to stop. It's when we get the shot, it's on our inside hip that he can defend pretty good. Right, he's still in a compromised position, but those rolls come much easier when we're like this compared to like this. He goes to roll, shoulder down, things like that. And really that was my main defense to funk rolling. Because if you shoulder down, it's pretty hard to roll through. Knee pull, same thing. So I'm here. Going knee pull, and I'm gonna go knees behind knees. It's the emphasis. Boom. And then I put off my curling right there. Right here. There's a bunch of different finishes. Up. I just like going up with it. It's my favorite tree topping. That's essentially that, right? It's more about the underhook and forcing him into bad positions than it is actually being very mobile. Right? I'm not that mobile. Right? I have tight hamstrings, but I'm making it easier on myself by not allowing him to do the things he wants to do. Right? He wants to sprawl and get that foot out. I'm beating him to the position. Right? I'm dictating where our wrestling is going to take place. Right? And I said that a lot. I say that a lot. Right? You got to dictate the outcome of the position, right? I think a lot of things for me, something that was also very important, it's not just the attention to detail, but it's having an answer, right, for everything. At least trying to have an answer for everything. So when something happens, I'm not like wide-eyed. By exposing yourself to different fields and making yourself do it. Anybody have any questions about just that?
Any got the head on the outside, are you like worried that if he does like a left hand fireman's, like that's gonna be there for him, or it's so tight that you can't even get it?
No, there's definitely, I mean, there's,
yeah, right.
Right, fireman's carry.
I think if you have a good underhook, right, fireman's carry is come elbow from elbows down, right? If my elbow is down, he can do a lot of things now. Right, so when I think about going, I don't do a swim, but I do a swim high crouch. Right, it gets me here, and I go like this. Right, I get that elbow in, and I'm going. Right. If I keep my elbow tight and up, you can still go for it. Right, he goes for it, but I'm gonna be able to stop him. Right, my hands high. A lot of times they go right through. Right, or if he does get to the leg, right, he gets to the leg. It's hips back. Right, I'm keeping this is the blocker right here, right? It's not his tool, it's mine. Right, so that's how I usually stop it. Right, elbow out, elevated. Second elbows go down, you're lower. Right, you have to change the position. So elbow tight or top, and you're able to get your head down to there. That's also why I put my head on the opposite side. Because you would think, okay, if my head's on the same side, I'm probably gonna have better defense. But in reality, I have better defense initially for here. But the second he beats my head and goes to fireman's carry, my head is beat. I'm in some trouble. But being here, he goes fireman's carry. My head, I know where my head's at. Right, he's not dictating the control, the motion of my head. Right, I'm able to dictate that, so it's easier for me to defend there. But when they, I mean, that's why I go so high crotch there, because I'm throwing their head, their shoulder, everything over my back. We would definitely work on this a lot. Right, so if you know a guy, you know, the two times I was hit with an inside trip, it wasn't actually the trip. That got me. Right? The trip is not the part I worry about. It's where my elbows are. Right. One of the hardest defenses for an underhook, right, is when a guy is comfortable with going up. Right. He's comfortable with going up. Very hard. It's very hard to get things going from an underhook. The guy is not trying to back away a little bit. Right. So. What I did a lot was, you know, we're here, and he goes to, you know, jack me up, right? It's switching my feet and drag it down, right? And then, right, I go to drag it down. Oh, right. So you can't expect to wrestle from here if you're not comfortable here. Right, trying to wrestle in someone else's position here, he's dictating, right? He's dictating where the wrestling is taking place. Right, he's up. And me trying to do moves there, those aren't my moves, those aren't the positions I want to be in. Right, so we have to change the course of action, change where the wrestling is taking place. So all I did was, again, switch, set a couple left hand feet, right? I can mitigate what he could do by not letting him go over under, because now we're at 50-50. More like 60-40, because I'm not very comfortable here. Right, I could still control a little bit here. He goes up, I switch, get it down. Right, if he goes to go back up, boom, sweeps, things like that, other things. But really, I mean, it's a difficult position, right? That's probably, like, if you wrestle from elbows, the guy who dumb blocks the straight arms is gonna have an advantage there, because that's a hard position to wrestle for a guy who wrestles all the time. It's a technical solution, but yeah, just dragging him back down, not letting that uprightness come into you, right? And getting his feet moving. Elbow comes from hips back, right? So look at his body and his position. He throws his hips back, right? You know, Nolf, which is actually really a brilliant defense at the time, because no one ever did that to me. I was like, what do you mean? Throw your hips back and just try to flee out of the position, right? And so he gets his hips back, and that's why I rely a lot on that snap, pull him under, weigh on him. But you know, I would give that fill here, and I did pull under so many times, it was like, okay, well, he's gonna pull me under, right? But instead of pulling under, I took a real hard stagger stance here, like this, and I controlled in the armpit. This is where I want to do a throw by from. Right, I could do a throw by from here. The problem is, his hand's kind of hurting. My goal with this position to score is I need to get his hands to go from there to there. Right? Number one objective, hands on the mat. Hands on the mat, you're way less mobile to get away. Right? Hands, if I don't get those hands over on the mat, it's kind of hard to score. I've missed this a lot. I mean, I've missed it several times. So, all I'm going to do is take a hard staggered stance, right? Stay tight, and I'm doing a knee drop. Over. And I'm trying to pinch his arm. Right? This is where I'm catching. I'm pinching. And just collapse. Right, so I'm pushing into him. Again. And on the opposite side, well, he goes, he's sagging his hips, and he's going, and he stays, and he pushes back into me, right? That's what we're doing. Boom. See how his hands got on the mat? Much easier to take him down. More times than not, you're not going to be able to pinch that ankle as good as you want, but it's just a split second pinch. We catch his hips, and then we run him down. So what that looks like. Push his back. Run him down. Catch the hips.
Is that head still on the opposite side that you throw that from?
Yep. I'm suctioning this arm and this head. I'm suctioning them together. Right, instead of throwing the arm, I'm throwing the head and the arm over. Right, this, hard to keep your balance there. Right, much easier to keep your balance if it's just going like this. Okay, so, yeah, I want to keep that because I'm creating a lot of tension. And then once you release, it's like a top.
So you're throwing that basically because of his defense is making you move with a different way.
Yeah, it's having an answer to the position.
Okay.
Right, that technique developed more out of necessity than anything. Because I didn't really do it before, right? Everything was here. Right? Everything was there. Right? And as soon as someone threw their hips back, no, I can no longer get, you know, to that position. Right? So I had to come up with something. Right? So it developed more out of necessity than anything. And that's why I stress the importance of doing those things. Getting those different fills in practice. It's more than just drills, guys. It's a philosophy of being prepared, right? Getting your guys to, you know, stressing that they have to buy in if they want to be great, right? It's a lot of wrestling, guys, is all about desire, right? And getting the most out of your athlete. It's about fostering that desire, right? They want to be great. It's great. It's awesome to be around those kids that want to be something. So, it's just you got to stress that buying. A lot of these positions, a lot of these answers and technical positions, they come from a hunger for knowledge. Ready to be, to have an answer, to never get caught off guard. Right, a kid that really wants to win, you have to like make them, but it won't be making them do it. After a little while, right? It takes a little bit of, you know, pushing from the back, but a kid that wants to be great, we'll learn to figure it out. So, are there any more questions from that position?
Question, Eddie.
I actually had an issue with this in a little while back. I'm like, I do the underhooks. What do you mean? Like, you're getting an underhook on me, you can't do that. really depending. When you have knowledge of a position and someone starts doing it to you, it's much faster to like pick up what you do wrong, right? And so for me, I don't want to hang out in underhook for very long, right? If a guy hangs out in underhook with me, it's it's game over, right? It's, I'm gonna get to something. So as soon as I feel it, I'm setting up a shot, but I'm not gonna go. I hate going arm over. I just don't, right? I've just, so many times I've gotten it, guy goes arm over, I'm like, thank you. Well, got it now, right? So what I do is as soon as he digs it in there, right? I'm thumb blocking, and he's going away, and he goes to jack it up, and I'm going into a high crotch here, right? Because I know what I would do, right? He goes to block the inside here, and I go to jack him up, right? I'm vulnerable. Right, so that's what I would do. And I'm immediately lowering my levels, and getting my hand as close as I can to his thigh on the inside, right? And most of the times, I can get away with this, right? He'll just abandon the position. But we got a stubborn one here. He'll go to jack it up, and right, I'm creating that tension. Boom. Just hand it in the back of my pocket. Yeah. Right? So I'm creating that space, and then pulling him in. Hand in the back of the pocket. Yeah. One time. He did, and immediately I'm going down. Right? And then he goes to jack it up. Throwing that arm over. Coming up. I lefty high crotch, right? So a guy is, you know, he blocks me in, right? And he's not necessarily creating that much space, but he's just blocking in and down. All I'm gonna do is I'm gonna throw this arm in, and I'm going to my high crotch on the opposite side, right? I'm going pull, and out. Sagging down, stuff like that, and blocking on the inside. Right, I gotta pull him in just a little bit tighter here. Right, I don't go like this anymore because I know a swim high crotch is coming. If the guy knows what he's doing. Right, instead of going up, I'm going in. In. And once I feel that like tension, I'm either gonna go high crotch or I'm gonna shoot the same shot just with my hand to the double. Right, so I would go boom, or I go boom. There. And the finish is the same, guys. Backhand deep, trail leg up. Right, so my shoulder is out a lot on that one. And not very good position here. And again, the way I solve this, because I really don't hit my knee very much here. The way I solve this is up, foot out. Right. You kind of always solve bad technique by getting them up. Right, if all else fails, get high. Get them high. But that's push, high cross.
Thank you.
Right, and over tie has kind of been a newer thing, right, with Kyle Snyder and Jason Nolf, like basically perfecting that over tie snap. For me, it's not, I don't necessarily like the over tie. I think what's great about an over tie is it's very weird. It's a weird build. Right, guy goes collar, and I just go like this. Right, he's like, why aren't you fighting back inside? It's just like a different kind of build. So I think that's why it's been having a lot of success the past couple of years. It's I don't want to say revolutionary, but it's a new technique. Right, no one has an answer to it. So
people feel safe.
Oh yeah,
they feel safe.
They feel safe, yeah, it's definitely a thing. So what I do from the over tie is, there's two things I like to do. I like a slide by, or I like I call it a slide by, a shot, right? So what I do for that slide by is I work here, and I'm pinching my head in, and what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna fake an attack here, and bang, out into a slide by. Everyone see that motion? It's like a rock step. Right? I create a rock step. Thank you. Right? Just like I'm a boxer, right? This is combat. And we'll see if you actually right? His knees are bent. It's hard to get a slide back. His weight doesn't. It's going to get him here. We're like, yeah, knee straight, hips out, you know, same kind of thing. But that's what we're looking for. And when he doesn't, I'm going to show you what I do. So if I can get a good fake, right? I get a fake, and he gets his hips back a little bit. All I'm going to do is fake back and with his free hand. I don't really go here. I actually go U grip here. Right, I try to think about the same motion I do with the other side. Try to get his hands there. Just tap it. Right. Probably the lowest effort takedown I got. Right, lowest amount of energy expended to get a takedown. These are really good at the beginning of periods. Right, because what happens is the whistle blows. He wants to go heavy. Right, he goes, oh, I just go cool. Fake out. Right, I had to fake that time. Right, he goes heavy. I'm immediately. Okay, one more time. Here. No. Say we're actually wrestling here. No, I dig. He digs, right? And that's how also we create tension there. Is I go collar tie, he digs in, and I go boom. And then I swear. Right? That motion is just over my own hip. Over my own hip side step. Sometimes I don't get it, but it's pretty safe as long as you're not doing this. Right. As long as you're not stepping straight knees. I'm not, again, I want to attack guys with a straight knee. I don't want to be straight knee. Right. So if I miss, what happens is he runs out. There. And it's also good because we're getting that, we're creating motion. So, if he doesn't give me a reaction, this is what I do. Alright, so I'm here, he goes big and his knees are still under him. Alright, his knees are still under him. I go hand up to the wrist and I rip it down. Right? Alright. Rip it down. Right, his knees are under him. I just go like this, move my head out of the way, and then just create that motion, I drop in. Right? It's like a whipping motion. Get it. Knee behind your knees. Right, that's my point of emphasis. Getting up, get it on the outside hip.
So for them, it feels like a slide by, and then you get them to single.
Yeah. Well, it's not feels like a slide by. It's like a setup to a slide by, but he knows it's coming, so he's staying ready. Right? What happens when guys stay ready there? Right? They're pretty light with his hand. Right? Because if you know a slide by is coming there, you just want to drop your hand and get it down to that leg. So we take advantage of that. I take advantage of basically like chess, right? Predicting his next move, right? And again, this comes from sparring, throwing out positions, right? So if he doesn't move, he's pretty light with that hand. Right? Outside hip, off my trail leg. I can't stress how important it is to get his foot to the outside hip. I wouldn't say it's a miracle finish, but because it's hard to do, right? It's hard. It's a lot of effort to get that foot on the outside hip, but if you can train that kind of always going to it, it gets easier. They do it. They seek it out. I start having defenses, and I have to develop something else that they're not ready for. Right? But it all comes from my core base moves, right? Underhook, go by, underhook, knee pick, underhook, swing single, things like that. So I started rushing a lot from elbows when I would dig an underhook here, and the guy would slip right away, right in this position. Right? I dig an underhook, guy slipped me, I'm here. Right. It's not like letting him just get away, right? It's having a secondary attack. And there's countless things I do for that. Right? Everything, my moves don't change necessarily, but my ways of getting there, like what I said earlier, with still focusing on doing what you're doing in different positions, My moves are essentially the same. I did develop one more that's really served me well. Is a elbow control to a cross knee pick. Kind of, if you have stronger guys, this is kind of the move for them, right? Not hard by any stretch of the imagination. You're literally taking the elbow through the opposite hip and catching them at the far pick, right? It's very like low technical move that is pretty safe. Right, so he slips my underhook, and I'm going up, either on the tricep. As far as this cross knee pick, I like it's still elbow control, right? Even though I'm not on the elbow, this is elbow control. Right? I want to pinch his head in there. I want to pinch his head. Okay. Now all I'm gonna do is I'm gonna pull it into me and take it over across. Right? Had a lot of success with this recently. Is you're ready for the underhook, you slip it, I'm catching them here. Just going full and changing my levels down and taking this arm through this hip. That's what I'm thinking about. I'm thinking about turning his body and catching here and running through. Right? There's no finish. Collapse. Right? Collapse, finish. Don't gotta like run up the legs, don't have to worry about getting his foot to the outside hip. It's a great shot for stronger guys. I would actually recommend this for more, like 84, 97. These guys are very cool. And so those guys are stronger than most wrestlers. So it's, love it. I absolutely love this move. And the reason why I like it is this, right? I miss it, I go like this, and I go and I miss, right? It just runs out. I just miss. There's nothing there. Right? There's no real, like, unless he could, like, do a headshot, which I've only ever seen Steven Abbas do it good, like, really good, like, phenomenal. Love him, never wrestled like him, but I love watching him wrestle. Unless he got a headshot, you don't really got much there. So, again, and I do this also for arm snaps. Right, we're here. Go like this, snap that arm, and I just go here. Right, because if you arm snap, my hand comes back up. Right, that's just a basic hand fighting skill. Snap the arm, my reaction is to go back up. Okay. Any questions there?